Morning. It's nice to see you here today. I want to begin by saying thanks to all of you who helped with the community meal last week. It was quite successful. Did a lot of work in the kitchen that day. Thanks to Bill and others who organized and everybody who participated and contributed. By way of announcements, invite you to join us on Ash Wednesday, February 22nd at 6:15 p.m. for a brief worship service of prayer, remembrance, and commitment. And those of you who are involved in Frankful Friday, get all geared up for, again, this Friday. And anybody who would like to join us, we would welcome you there. We will be sharing a free hot dog meal at around noon, but the Big Tree, at the entryway, weather permitting, and based on what I'm looking at on the Weather Channel, it looks like it's going to be a pretty good day. So food preparation will begin at 10, and we will start distributing the food, as I said, around noon at the Blessing Box. If anyone is interested in joining the Saturday Night Alive Planning Committee, please let Eric know. And yes, it is alive, not just live. We might get in some legal issues if we call it that. And for our mission of the month, we are collecting tissues for our January ministry to Spindell Elementary School. So if you haven't gone out and purchased a couple of boxes, you still have time to do that. Are there any other announcements anyone has? Okay, please join me in prayer. On this day, Lord, we give you thanks for bringing us together for this time of worship. We pray for those who are here, for those worshiping with us remotely, and those for whatever reason are unable to participate, be it illness or simply lack of the means to do so. We pray for our neighbors near and far. We pray for victims of violence everywhere, whether it be domestic violence in a nearby home or the insidious violence of racism, homophobia, anger, and misunderstanding. We pray for victims of the widespread violence of wars, pitting factions against factions, nations against nations. We especially pray for Ukraine as it enters its second year of fighting for its sovereignty. As we enter this service, we pray for this church, for its mission of serving you while serving others. We pray for Pastor Eric as he brings us today's message. Amen.
I am tired and weak. Amen. Wow. I felt like we were visiting the Delta Blues there for a little while, getting down. Diane, that was amazing. Choir, that was, whoo. We've got some musical talent in this church, and I am on fire right now, okay? You may not be safe for a few minutes as the Holy Spirit's moving me right now. But I do want to welcome you back to part three of our sermon series called Long As I Can See the Light, where what we're talking about is being tuned in enough where we'll see God's light in all things. Now, as we've done during each week of this series, what I want to do to begin with, as we start out today anyway, is ask another question. Are you ready for a question? Anyone? One person? Susan's ready for a question. There are a couple people back. Yeah, here we go. I saw Sheila back there. Here's your question, and it's important. And I just want to say this, if you're in Bible study, you've already heard this question. So there you go. There's your encouragement to come to Bible study, right? You get a preview of what we're talking about. Here's the question. How many of you would say that at some point in your life, you have felt the presence of God? Raise your hand if you have felt the presence of God. Okay, all right, that's good. Now, for all of you who did not say yes to that question, here's a follow-up question. How many of you would say that you are not sure if you have felt the presence of God? No one wants to answer that question, right? But I would dare say there are more people than you would think who are not sure they have felt the presence of God. And it can be a bit confusing, really, as to, is it God that I'm feeling? Is it God that I'm hearing? Those kind of things. For example, if you think about it, God's presence can make you, what, very emotional. But in a very similar way, the same kind of feeling can manifest, really, if you're watching cute little puppies on YouTube. You get that same emotional feeling, Kathy? You get that? I do. I cry. Not so much with cats, but with puppies, I get very emotional in that way. Did you guys notice I don't like cats? Is anyone catching my vibe up here? I don't know if you guys caught that. And further, God's presence can make you feel this deep sense of peace too, right? I mean, you feel this peace and comfort like it's really hard to describe, but also, you know, you can get that same kind of feeling wearing your PJs, eating cereal, and watching Looney Tunes, you know, on a Saturday night. It's the same kind of way. I can feel peaceful when I'm doing that, but I feel so alone right now because apparently you don't feel that way. But it is confusing sometimes as to whether or not we have felt God's presence. And so when it comes to feeling sure that it's God's presence that you're experiencing, how do you arrive at a place of certainty, much like what the psalmist felt when he wrote this in Psalm 16? And this is powerful. He said, I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever. How amazing is that? I mean, that's a great place to find oneself. And so again, for those of you who are not real sure you're feeling God's presence or if it's something else, yet you want to, with all the pieces of your heart, to experience and connect with our Father in heaven, how do you do that? How does that happen? I mean, how do you get to a place where you feel, where when you want to feel God's presence, that you do, even though God may feel so far away? Well, to that latter question, I want to tell you that if you don't always feel, the presence of God, you're not alone. You're absolutely not by yourself. In fact, this is what the psalmist wrote in Psalm chapter 88, verses 13 and 14. He said this, but I cried to you for help, Lord. Now, you could feel his pain. Picture this. But I cried to you for help, Lord. In the morning, my prayer comes before you. Why, Lord, do you reject me and hide your face from me? And so if you've ever wondered why you don't always feel the presence of God, what I wanted to do today really is give some scriptural reasons as to why this might happen. And here's the first one. The first one is this. Maybe we're over-sensationalizing God's presence. Have you ever thought about that? Over-sensationalizing God's presence. Well, what does that mean? Well, what it means is that maybe you're looking for God as always being this supernatural, spiritual juggernaut whose light is so blinding and presence so tangible that you, like John Belushi on the Blues Brothers, anyone ever see that? You can say when you felt, Susan, thank you, you're working with me this morning, I'll tell you. You, like John Belushi on the Blues Brothers, can say, I have seen the light. Is that up here? There you go. I have seen the light. If you hadn't seen the movie, you need to, because then you will see the light after you've seen that. In other words, perhaps you are in some way expecting God to give you a sign that would prove beyond a shadow of a doubt, not only that God is here with you, but also that God cares for you too. Now, when it comes to people needing to see a definitive sign of God's presence, this is not something that just happened overnight. In fact, in John chapter 6, verse 30, this is what some people were saying to Jesus. They were kind of on the fringes of their faith, kicking the tires of what's going on with this whole new movement. And this is what they were asking Jesus. He said, Jesus, what sign will you give us? What sign will you give us so that we may see it and do what? And believe in you. What will you do? In other words, Jesus, what are you going to do to impress us? Jesus, what is your next trick? Jesus, what are you going to do to prove your divinity? Give us a sign. Give us a show. Give us an explosion. Give us some pyrotechnics. Give us something to prove that you are who you say you are. Now, unfortunately, the truth is that a lot of people in the church world really crave having these kind of signs from God, right? And honestly, I get it. I mean, I really do. For example, let's say you're trying to figure out if you should be dating someone, right? And this is a very practical application. You're trying to figure out if the person you're dating is someone that you should stay with or make them go away. Well, you may ask God for a sign, right? Something like, if it's the right person, then tell me. Or if it's the wrong person, say something like, thou shalt breaketh up with them because an upgrade cometh. It's in King James, so it's got to be legit, right? And it sounds like something God would say, right? Or, God, should I change jobs? I can't stand this job anymore. I want a different one. So then you might say, God, if it's your will for me to switch jobs, well, just send a camel in the room, because you don't see that every day, do you? You don't see a camel. I've never seen it. Have you ever seen it? I've never seen a camel walk in the room. God, send me a camel, and then I'll know it's you telling me to switch jobs. Now, while I know that all that sounds ridiculous and hyperbolic and even sarcastic, but in truth, it's not really that far removed from how some people expect God to react, right? And so with that said, the question really boils down to this. Is that really how God works? Does God really work that way? I mean, can we just go up and rub his righteous belly and then out comes a prize? Is that how it works? Well, no, it's not. I mean, just think about it. After coming to this earth, I mean, look, this is being very serious. After coming to this earth and putting on the human suit and then being ostracized and betrayed and brutalized and killed on our behalf, what else does God have to do to prove God's self to us, right? It's kind of like a couple weeks ago, and I was in dire need of some wood. I just needed some wood. I needed some wood to burn. I was like, who do I call? And I was like, I'm going to call my buddy Wayne Henson because he knows everything and everybody. And he happened to have some property with some wood on it. And this guy is so nice, he went out with his chainsaw and cut the wood the day before we went and picked up the wood. And I'm like, wow, Wayne is awesome. I knew that. Wayne is awesome. So we do that, and we get it back, and it's raining a little bit that day, and we get back to the parsonage, and we're unloading it, putting it under the shelter there. And, of course, I forgot. My dad always said, you make sure that you take care of people who take care of you. Actually, you should be take care of everybody, whatever, but take care of people who take care of you. And I was like, Wayne was kind of driving away, and I was like, ran him down. I said, Wayne, how much do I owe you for this? And he said, you couldn't afford it. Wayneism of the day. You couldn't afford it. You see, friends, God paid a debt for us that we could not afford. We can chase him down all we want to and offer him this or that. We could not afford it. And so when we look up at the sky and ask God for a sign, but then we don't get what maybe what we wanted, and then we start to wonder, God, what's wrong with you? What does that say about us, really? You see, feelings and signs of wonder and emotion aren't the only evidence of the presence of God. And you see, I say that because if we always felt God, if we always knew God was there, then where would faith come into play? We wouldn't need faith if God was always standing right there in all times. So in short, if you don't feel like you're experiencing the presence of God, With a maybe, you're over-sensationalizing it, meaning that maybe you're looking for a definitive sign from God, when the truth is, Jesus has already delivered a pretty powerful one on the cross, I would say. Now, a second reason we might not be experiencing God's presence is that perhaps over the course of time, your heart has hardened. Maybe your heart has hardened, meaning that based on some event or situation in your life, maybe your heart has grown cold towards the things of God, and that happens quite often. I can tell you, as a pastor, I see it quite often. In fact, in Matthew 13, Jesus was quoting a prophecy from Isaiah, and he said this. He said, "You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this, people's hearts have become calloused. Their heart, they hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes." And so, why don't you always experience the presence of God? Well, maybe for you, you're a person of faith who has just been beat up by the circumstances of life. You know, someone who has faced some kind of hardship or loss or disappointment or hurt, and because of that, you're just wrapped up in grief and weariness to the point that you're not real sure you can even trust God anymore. Now, even further, perhaps for other people, their heart is hardened because they haven't forgiven that person who hurt them. I'm gonna pause on that one right there, because I think that could speak for a lot of us in some situation. Haven't forgiven that person that hurt them, who maybe broke their heart, who wronged them in some way or left them when they said they would never leave them. And so now they are so consumed by their bitterness and the trauma of it all that they can't feel anything, much less God. I mean, it's much like that scene from Friends. Any Friends fans in here? Anyone watch Friends? I watch way too much television and movies. Two people know what Friends is. But there was this one scene where Joey was on there, and he put on all of Chandler's clothes. We have a picture of that up here. Right there. I mean, sometimes we can be so insulated in the same way, so wrapped up in all this bitterness and trauma, that we can barely move, and we certainly aren't going to feel anything when we're wrapped up like that, right? You see, when we're like that, so wrapped up in unforgiveness and bitterness, etc., when then there is very little to no chance that God's presence could ever break through all the layers that we've added, right? And so, in short, maybe the reason that some people don't feel God's presence is that they've kind of made friends, if you will, with the bitterness and unforgiveness and drama to the point that it has hardened their hearts. Now, a third reason that we may not always feel God's presence is that, and this is my favorite just for the record, but is that God just wants to draw us closer to himself. God just wants to draw us closer to himself. In fact, in Acts chapter 16, this is what it says as we find Paul preaching in Athens. It says, "From one man, God made all nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far away from any one of us." And so, why did God do this? Well, God did this perhaps because he wants us to reach out to him so that we would, in some sense, miss the relationship, miss him, so that we would crave him and realize just how much we actually need God, right? You see, sometimes it's during the hard times and the challenges and the suffering that we seek God the most. Have you noticed that? It's during the good times we're like, "God, I've got it. I'm good." It's during the suffering and the challenges and the down times where we really seek to be with God. And it's also in those times where we grow in our faith most times, and in our trust in who God is. And it's also the time where we miss God the most. Now, I have to say this. This is an admission this morning, but in seventh grade, it was a trying time. I mean, you're just kind of figuring out your emotions and who you are and all that. And I fell in love with a girl named Marie. I did. She was probably my first love next to Wonder Woman. She was my first love. Linda Carter, Wonder Woman, by the way. Back, you remember, you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, she was my first love, but Marie was my second love, and I was head over heels, but at the same time, I was also cheap. So, and I thought about this week because we just had Valentine's Day and I have grown from the experience, but I was like, okay, I really love Marie, but I also don't have a lot of money and I don't want to spend a lot of money on her, so I broke up with her before Valentine's Day. So I didn't have to buy her chocolates or anything like that, which was a great plan. I mean, I had all the candy to myself, and I was like, I don't got to worry about all that stuff and got to take her out. I wasn't going to take her out to eat because I couldn't drive, but do anything else, spend any money on her, period. That is until, like, the day after. And I was like, I kind of miss talking to Marie. She was, you know, my little heart was pittering and pattering, and the songs got really sad, and they all seemed to say her name. And there was even this product on TV, you may remember this, called Marie's Mayonnaise. Do you remember that? Mayonnaise by Marie. And maybe I just saw it because I was so sad. Maybe it's not a real thing. I don't know. But I saw that and I just started weeping. I was like, I miss Marie. I miss Marie. You know what? I think in the same way, God works the very same way. I mean, we put God on a shelf when everything's good. We don't need you right now, God. We put him away because we don't want to do the work. We don't want to pay the price or whatever we have to do. And so we end up missing God, missing what we have. We end up realizing that God was exactly what we needed in all things. You see, God wants us to want him. God wants us to want him. He wants us to want him, need him, crave him, long for him, thirst for him, buy him chocolates, whatever you want to do for God. God wants you to pursue him, really. Why? Well, because when we pursue God, that makes it legitimate. That means that we actually miss God. It means that we actually want to have a relationship with God and that we're not just going through the motions of having to do all this just because it's the righteous thing to do or because of our spouse or significant other or brother or sister, mother, father, whatever made us do it or pressured us into doing it. It's kind of like this. Again, TV, this is kind of what motivates me, but how many cartoon fans in here? You guys like cartoons? Any of anyone ever heard of Pepe Le Pew? We can't really talk about him now for some reason, but I'm going to do it anyway. We're doing it in a church, so we're sanctifying the conversation about Pepe Le Pew. But no one knew about pursuing like Pepe Le Pew, right? You remember that poor little cat? I can't believe I'm saying poor little cat in a sentence. That poor little cat would always get that stripe of paint on her back, and Pepe was on the move. Pepe loved, and he was speaking French, and he was real romantic and all that kind of stuff. That is what... And remove all the weirdness from that. I think we had a picture of Pepe up there. Was he up there? Remove all the weirdness from that comparison. God really wants us to be motivated in that same kind of way to pursue God. How many times have you heard me say, if you do church 1 hour a week, you're not doing it right? You're not getting much? If I'm the only Jesus you're seeing in a week, I feel you're anemic now, okay? You're not getting enough Jesus. Jesus wants you to pursue God. To pursue like Pepe. Think about Pepe at all times, hopping around, singing, I'm going to the Casbah, or whatever he's saying, like speaking French love things, or whatever. God wants us to go after God at all times, because God is relational. God wants our heart, our devotion, our passion, our pursuit. In fact, in Jeremiah 29:13, God gives us an incredible promise. He really does. This is what God says. He says, you will seek me, and find me when you seek me with all your heart, right? That's not 1 hour a week. That's not what it says, is it? With all your heart. In all your ways is what it says. And then it says, I will be found by you, declares the Lord. You see, when we truly seek God, God will reveal God's self in a very tangible way. Not because he has to, not because he has to prove it to you, not because he's a diva, okay? But rather because God has already proven to us countless times before that God loves us, right? That he is worthy of our pursuit. So, as we wrap up this morning, if for whatever reason you are having trouble feeling God's presence, here's an important truth you need to hold on to, okay? Here it is. Just because God feels distant doesn't mean that God is absent. Just because God feels distant doesn't mean that God is absent. You see, oftentimes God works in the ordinary. Have you noticed that? God works in the ordinary. Things like having lunch with a friend, whatever, whenever that is. Celebrating with someone when there's a victory. Mourning with someone or grieving with them when there is a loss. Even further, God can manifest when we watch our kids take their first steps or when they take their first fall. That's kind of funny too, isn't it? When they fall over, I don't know, I'm just calling me crazy. Or when we're taking a hike in the mountains. Man, what a this. We used to vacation here. Now we live here. I mean, I'm from the coast and I love the ocean, but it was always my wallpaper. I got here, it's like I'm going to vacation land. So I love walking around looking at the majesty of the mountains here. Or it could be while you're taking a walk along the ocean. And it's even, it can even come when you're playing pickleball with a friend in a losing effort, like I did this week. Okay, I lost this week. I had to get that out. Sean, there you go, buddy. Had to get it out there. So yeah, God's presence is amazing. We can see God in just the ordinary. So yeah, if or when we don't feel God's presence, don't take that as a sign that it's time to bail on God. Don't do that. I mean, just like when your spouse gets on your nerves, and if you're married, your spouse gets on your nerves sometimes, right? Right, Walter? What? Walter wasn't touching that one, Lucille. He was like, no. So, I mean, just when that happens, and it does happen. It happens to all of us. You don't just turn away. You don't turn your back on them. Or it's like when your kids are driving you crazy because they do. You don't just drop them off on the side of the road and say good luck, even though it would feel good in the moment to do that, right? You don't do it. No, if we truly desire God's presence, people stay with me, well, then we won't over-sensationalize it, and we won't approach God with a hardened heart, and we will accept the fact that God actually wants to have a relationship with us. God wants us to pursue God. God wants us to draw closer to him. And why is that true? Well, because the scripture says when God looks at us, God doesn't see a bunch of misbehaving, arrogant, talking heads who keep bumping into each other. But all God really sees are people whom God loves. People whom God also knows couldn't afford to do what God did for us. That's what God sees. Folks, we need to get over each other, get over ourselves, I should say, in the long run and realize this life is short. There's a lot of bad things happening in this country, in this world right now, and it really, really needs to see the love of the church in a lot of ways. There was another shooting last night, another one the night before that, etc. You know, feeling the presence of God, I can imagine God's just in heaven shaking God's head, going, what is going on down there? Don't think for a second that God doesn't love you. Don't think for a second that God doesn't love your enemy. God loves everyone whom God created. That's just how it works. And if you want God's presence in your life, sometimes we have to step back, or as James Brown said, have to step back, kiss myself, and move on. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's all about God. If you want to feel God's presence in your life, take a legitimate step in God's direction. Be willing to pursue God. Don't look for the bells and whistles, those kind of things. God is not your dog and pony show. God is not that kind of God, but God is with you every step that you take in this life, and it will make a huge difference, not just in this church, not just in this community, but the entire world when we realize that we need God in our lives. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's pray. Most Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your presence. We thank you for your work that you did for us on the cross that we could not afford. Thank you for showing up in the ordinary. Thank you for just reminding us that we need to slow down so we can understand that it's you there with us. That is so important for you to be in our lives, to direct us, to speak truth into our lives, to our hearts, not in a way that we go out and judge other people or use it against other people, but as a growing point, to realize that we have not arrived. We have not. We're not... You know, we have a lot of improvement to do in our lives, really. So we have to be willing to take a hard look at ourselves, at our own blind spots. Lord, I just ask for the forgiveness for all of us in this world now who are just this so full of hate, so full of things going on that just are unimaginable. You turn on the TV and there's this violence after violence. And it's just so hard to comprehend how this is the reality that we live in now. But I can say this. I know that you gave us the church as a gift, and I pray that we as the church step up and start loving people the way we need to and helping people get the help they may need or getting the help that we may need. but always, always pursuing your presence in our life at all times, because that's where the rubber hits the road. For us, in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Just a couple reminders about this week. We have our Ash Wednesday service this Wednesday, and it is a floating service. Don't realize if you get here a little bit late, it's okay. Just come as you can. It'll probably be up until about 7, and we'll conclude at that point. But we'll have a little bit of scripture reading and kind of talking about what Ash Wednesday is, and then we'll have the distribution of the ashes after that. So come and join us this Wednesday if you can. This Friday we'll have Frankful Fridays. If you've been part of that crew, you know there's a lot of fun if you've supported it. It is doing a lot of good in this community. So if you want to be a part of that, let us know. Just stop by and help us out or whatever you want to do, and it'd be great fun. Any other announcements that I may have forgotten? You guys are awful quiet this morning. And nothing else? We're going to say a prayer. I feel like I needed to say something else, and I just forgot it. I don't know what it is. I totally forgot it. I'll put it on Facebook. Let's pray. Most Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time of worship today. Thank you for making it possible for us to come together corporately and worship you. You are a God who is so worthy of our worship. I pray that we, as we say every week, that we understand the church starts now, that there's a lot of work to be done in this world, and you've equipped us to do it. So I pray that our eyes are open and our ears as well, so we can see and hear what you've put right in front of us. The person that needs to hear that word of encouragement or whatever we may offer, maybe we're the ones who need to hear that on the flip side. So Lord, I pray that we're in tune with your spirit throughout the week as you direct us. For in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. God bless you and have a great week.